Yeah, no, this is a good question. So no doubt really, everything is Sunnah, Qur'an is Sunnah. But you know, what happens is some people do something which does not contradict Sunnah and Qur'an is Sunnah, you know, it will be forbidden. No, we don't say it is forbidden. It really depends, you know, what category it comes. For example, Qur'an and Sunnah both encourage you to ask Allah, to seek His help, isti'ana, make dua. And there are many du'as which have been taught in the Qur'an and Sunnah, and they're really much more than enough if you follow them. But if people have their own du'as nicely, which does not have any shirk, any kufr, anything wrong, then no harm in that. You can make your own dua. Everybody is allowed to make dua. Companies used to make their own dua. Not everybody to follow Prophet ﷺ in this matter. You can make your own dua. So not necessarily you take from the. But what happens? Argument in the Quran. So Quran and Sunnah, they have got real argument. You must make dua. But Quran and Sunnah don't insist that words of dua must be from Quran and Sunnah. It is freedom. People are free for that. Similarly, you know, you people must eat when they're hungry. But Quran and Sunnah don't insist that you cook the food in a certain way. If you take from the experience of the people, that's fine. When people fall in, they must take treatment. They must make. But if but Quran and Sunnah don't insist it must be Arabic treatment. No, it could be from anyone. Any system which has developed certain treatment, you can take from that. You know, people. Quran and Sunnah, they encourage people to do business, to earn money, halal money. The, you know, kitab, kasb is encouraged. But not necessarily the business of Arab people. It could be business developed in any part of the world. People can do something like that. So many of the customs and cultures of the people, as long as they don't involve in any haram or any disliking, people are free. Quran and Sunnah don't insist you on a certain way of anything. It should be open more and more they can do. Problem happens when people do things, you know, which actually become parallel to Quran and Sunnah. Then it is problem. You know, something becomes parallel to, so, for example, ibadat. Ibadat certainly are not from human experience. Business can be human experience. Medicine can be from human experience. If you do halal medicine from any experience, that's fine. But ibadat are only revelation. So I do tawaf of the house of Allah because it is revelation. Quran says, Sunnah says. But somebody says that, you know, if you do tawaf of the grave of my Shaykh, you get amazing barakah and blessing and you get so many child and, you know, all those things. And then you do this, this is not right. Because this needs proof from Quran Sunnah. Because nobody is allowed to make a parallel Sunnah in this regard. Ibadah never can be made by the people. So is it clear to you? That is what people don't understand. For the Ibadah, you need evidence. For the other business, other than Ibadah, you need evidence of it not being haram. If not haram, you can do it. But nothing can be Ibadah unless it has proof in the Quran and Sunnah. So anything, okay, like for example, if people, some people say to you, if you make a dua, you know, after Dhuhr prayer, it has this reward, it needs proof. Dua is fine, but this new thing that you said, it needs proof. If people said that after Asr prayer, if you sit down after on Friday after Asr prayer, and you make this Darus Sharif, you know, Salat and the Prophet 80 times, and so much reward. Salat and the Prophet is fine, but this particular Salat, which particular, you know, benefit, it needs proof. And then no proof, all, you know, all these things are weak. That's what we have to have heard. Anything ibadah, you need proof. Anything non-ibadah, you need proof that it is not haram. When it's not haram, you can do it. Is it clear?